Okay, well, I'm really happy to be here
to introduce Mark.
For those of you who don't know me, which in this context means that don't follow me on Twitter, because I'm meeting in real life everybody today. I mostly work in neuroscience and biology, biochemistry, and I'm also a fiction writer. So lately, which means the last 5-6 years, I've been very much interested in trying to apply speculative philosophy to biology, but I'm not a philosopher, so I'm pretty sure that some things are not going to be philosophically correct, let's say. I'm not going to read a paper, because I'm really boring when reading, and I suppose that reading in English would be even more boring. So I tried to put together a few slides trying to explain a little bit some concepts related to speculative biology, and trying to explain maybe how this could be applied to speculative thinking in general, and also artificial intelligence and those kind of things. So if I put a lot of slides, so if you don't understand what I'm telling, you can read the slide at least. And if I am not able to explain something, you can always go to the algorithm and search it in Google, because most of things are easily found there. Okay, I have several parts. The first one is about speculative biology, and a concept that I've been very much interested in lately, which are cognitive morphospace, or cognitive morphospaces. I have several hypotheses that are just hypotheses. I mean, I wouldn't be able to explain them in detail, but I think some examples help us to understand what that I try to mean by this hypothesis. The hypothesis number one about speculative biology is that organisms in general, and this may include machines also, are context machines. We always think about organisms as content machines, and also the same with machines as content machines. But as it was explained before by Catherine, context is a very important thing, and maybe the most relevant feature of our current times is that context is exploding, context is collapsing. This is a quote, I think it's a literal quote, but I'm not sure, by Stuart Kaufman. Stuart Kaufman is a researcher on complexity, he's in Santa Fe Institute, and this is something that I like very much about how organisms, or what organisms are, and how organisms work. An organism is a hypothesis on the environment. So, an organism may be a system, assemblage of matter, object, whatever, depending on your ontology. As I said, I'm not an ontologist. For transforming time, complex time, into complex forms. In classic biology, in classic evolution theory, we always think as organisms or species are homeostatic. Homeostatic, I don't know if I'm pronouncing this well. I mean, organisms try or want to stay as they are, but specific environmental conditions force them to change. In my view, speculative biology just reverses this idea. So organisms or species are heterostatic. They want to change, but specific environmental conditions force them to stay as they are. So an organism or a species is always wanting to change, it's always trying to change. Second hypothesis, context, which is representational reality or representable reality, is the result of environmental interactions between living and non-living actors. Organisms have evolved to process and to produce context. which I try to define as a formal collection of temporary agreements which allows them, organisms, to be part of an environment they partially construct. This is also a very interesting point of view, because we used to think of organisms as something separated from the environment. Even if they are integrated in the environment, we never think that the organism is producing the environment, at least partially, which is a very also interesting concept. And the non-representational reality, the non-contextual reality, is what we could understand as noise. So my idea is, can we change, or can organisms change, not only humans, to adapt this noise to the environment? And then it comes the second idea, which are morphospaces. Spaces. This is also taken from biology. Morphospaces is a representation of all the possible forms, shapes, or structures of an organism. I think this is much better in this one. This would be a chart of a theoretical morphospace of a kind of organism, which are foraminifera. They are represented all the different forms, all the different shapes that this organism can present, can have. This is a more complex representation of morphospace. It's not for one organism, but for different organisms, including technology. You can see up there, I don't know if I can point with this here, but this tech is technology, ecological networks, and neural networks. So if an organism would be a hypothesis on the environment, a morphospace is a collection of hypotheses. When I was preparing this, I found this paper, and this is a paper about the possibility to design new morphospaces by synthetic biology. So it says that they propose a unifying framework that connects the concept of morphospace with synthetic biology and tissue engineering. So they are trying to occupy synthetic biology, they are trying to occupy all this space that they define as unexplored morphology space. They are different space that are occupied currently by current beings, by current organisms, and also by current machines, including neural systems, organs, etc. And all this space that they define as unexplored morphological space is what I try to define as noise, with a question mark, because I'm not really sure if this is correct. Well, this is occupying morphospace by design, but we can also think about occupying morphospace spontaneously, as an evolutionary process. And this is very speculative biology, but we could think as a whole biosphere, as an environment that was constructed, by different natural processes, as, for example, for optimizing by means of viral parasitism. This is very interesting. I mean, this is not, as I say, is speculative biology. It's not a theory or evolution theory. But what is represented here, this is the human genome, is not the last one, but this represents in the human genome the percentage of protein coding genes, which are the genes that we know. When we talk about the human genome being known or being sequenced, we are talking about this 1.5%. All the other human DNA is composed by different kind of structures, different kind of sequences, that mostly we don't know where they come from. Some of them are repetitive, there's a lot of repetitive DNA, and like 20 years ago this was known as junk DNA, but we don't know that it's not junk DNA anymore. All those sequences have functions, even if we don't know very well all the functions, but they are very implied in regulation of protein synthesis, and also they produce different types of RNAs that are also very important for that. So most of this foreign DNA comes from virus. So we may think about viruses at the beginning of the eukaryotic life as putting information in eukaryotic cells, and these cells change, creating organisms, and these organisms are the best environment for viruses. So we are all environment for viruses. We have been, in this sense, created by these viruses to have a better environment, because viruses are, of course, parasites. Well, this is just a comparison of DNA in different organisms, just to show that humans, where are humans? Humans are here. We have 25,000 around protein coding genes, and many other organisms like rice or C. elegans, etc., have the same or more. So we are not defined by the part of our DNA that synthesizes proteins, but by the rest of the DNA. Well, this is, I'm not going to discuss this in detail, because I'm not pretty sure also about everything that I put here, but it was an attempt to create a kind of map of possible morphospaces. So I charted, I put there, it shouldn't be flat, everything is running in all directions, but I charted deterministic versus random, which is partially correct, and meaning versus noise, which is also partially correct, and several different cross sections. I think the conceptual as going through, meaning the mystical as going through noise. But probably the most interesting thing for us now is this parasemic area. I put the Dionysian networks after reading a little bit of the of Melanthi's book last week. And maybe the most interesting opposition is the information versus the information, which I took also from Melanthi's book, and I think this is going to be developed probably soon in a more formal way. So the question is, if are we ready to move to this noise space? Are we ready to, are we moving into this, into this non-meaning or unformed space? So I go to the second part, which is about media and consciousness. And the next hypothesis is media are ahead of the art. Our media, our machines, are not state of the art. They are ahead of the art, and they are ahead in several different ways. Contemporary media are ahead human agency and perception. And I think that any contemporary art practice, including all forms of textual art, including literature of course, becomes a performance in and from the, this media scape. Hansen, in Feed Forward, studies this in a very interesting way. He says that 21st century media opened a new, properly post-phenomenological and non-prosthetic phase of technical distribution in which human experiencers become implicated in the larger environmental processes to which they belong, but to which they have no direct access via consciousness. Human consciousness is not central. We knew that from long ago, but we still keep working on the centrality of consciousness. Well, I mean, even if we try not to do so, the same way that we are being anthropomorphic all the time, even if we try not to do it. So we are implicated in processes that we neither control, directly enjoy, or even have access to. We humans cannot but come to appreciate our participation in a cosmology of processes, which is to say, to embrace our subjectivity implication in a plethora of processes of all sorts and all scales. Well, you all know this quote by Galloway about the a network as a pack of animals. And a couple of quotes by Baker about the idea of the semantic apocalypse. I highlighted the ecological invariants that technology is even now rendering plastic. I do not agree with that, because I think they were always plastic. We're just looking to a very short space of time, so we think they didn't change for this space of time. But they have been plastics, and in my idea of speculative biology is that, as I said before, organisms and species are always trying to change. So plasticity is on the base, on the essence of the existence of life itself. So we go to the crash space that was also mentioned this morning. And the same animal condition, more generally, is profoundly ecological. This is something very, very important when we understand that ecology is not something outside the organism, but is something that the organism is at least partially trying to construct. So this is from a forthcoming paper, will be published probably next month or something like that, about consciousness. And in response to these ideas, I wrote that consciousness is indeed a fiction, but eliminative materialism does not tend to fully understand what a fiction is. A fiction is not a solution, but an open question, an ongoing hypothesis, a journey, and more specifically, a returning trip from the outskirts of our capacities to grasp reality. It involves heuristic rules, but it's never a set of fixed hereditary rules. We are part of the environment, and we change it while it changes us. Consciousness is a fiction, but by being a fiction, it's a paradox, a tale told to guide organisms around cognitive morphospaces. Consciousness is also an instrument to explore the limits of that cognitive morphospace, the result of an evolutionary adaptation to recognize otherness. Life works as a permeable metabolic insulation from otherness, occurring through membrane exchange. Consciousness, as perceived by the individual, reflects the complexification of otherness, recognition patterns, continuously evolving into an apparently enclosed semiotic system known as self. So, fifth hypothesis, life is a semantic apocalypse in itself. It's all the time creating a semantic apocalypse. And the third part is about literature and how literature is reflecting this condition. One of the important characteristics of current literature is synchronicity, ubiquity, redundancy. Past and future are imploding into a synchronic syntopic narrative of the present. Identities and cultural memories are produced and discarded in real time. Digital synchronization allows the presentation of all available narratives in the same place at the same time, opening what I call networked time spaces, artworks that are neither single nor stable, but redundant, chaotic, vibratory, and meta stable. Yes, 2 minutes. Okay, I'm going really fast. A networked time space is a small piece of space-time produced by the synchronic activation of a discrete number of network elements by means of a particular performance. So everything happens in the same time, in the same space at the same time. Synchronicity, this is a little bit of the same. Okay, so the first art myth of our time is the fully automated avant-garde. But before that, we have some examples of human mediated or non-human mediated or non-human produced artworks. One example is written by Darby Larson. This is a very interesting novel. It's created by, not by the algorithm. He writes the story and then the algorithm processes the story. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of repetitive, very interesting. The feeling is a little bit like it creates a lot of anxiety when you are reading it. But it's a very, very good model, novel. It's very, very interesting. The Deletionists, this is a bot where you can upload any text and it will delete some parts of it. This is reverse OCR. I don't know if you know this bot. This creates random lines, and then it uses OCR technology to recognize the word. So the first thing that recognized as a word, it prints it. So the upper one is geology, the lower one is emotion. It's very interesting because it reverses the use of technology. This is Daniel Temkin. He does a lot of work online, but I am very interested in this one, which is Entropy from 2011. And it's also an algorithm where language, where data corrodes the more often it's used. So the more you use it, the more it's corroded. And of course, Christian Bock's Xenotext that I know, I think most of you know, so I'm not going more on that. And the Plantoid, which is also a very interesting artwork, which is a real machine, it's a real plant that grows by using the blockchain. So it's using bitcoins to pay artists to create more Plantoids. So the machine itself, the algorithm itself, is using people, is using the artists to proliferate. So I finish with this quote by Mogahec, saying that emergent literature must generate novel lines of incommunicability. It must compose territories of the incalculable, crafting contrivance after contrivance. And that's all.